Hello everyone, so this is GS Mains paper 3, August 2017, part 2. So the seventh topic and the first topic for today is Indian justice system and under trials. So first of all, what is the basic definition of under trial? What is an under trial, right? So under trial are those people who are not convicted of any crime and but they are currently on trial in a court of law, right? They're not convicted. They are accused, but they are not convicted of any crime. In December 2016, there was an article in Hindu which said about two-third of the prisoners in India are under trials, right? They don't have the money to get released on bail or something like that. So that is a sorry state of our justice system. So the thing is, speedy trials alone can undo the sense of injustice caused by acquittal after years in jail. So you have spent 2-3 years in jail and then it is proved that you are not guilty. So imagine the scenario, imagine the state of mental state of that particular person. Even if he is not a criminal, he will become a criminal because of whatever he has gone through, right? So speedy trial is the need of the hour because directly or indirectly it creates a lot of scenarios, right? And speedy trial is the only way to resolve all those issues, right? Serious introspection needed on the prevailing gulf between crime and justice. So we talk about conviction rate in this, conviction rate in that. Conviction rate in almost all the heinous crimes is very low, rape and all those things very low. So there is a very big gulf between crime and justice, and that has to be bridged at any cost. Okay, now justice, if it has to be substantial means if it has to be meaningful, it cannot be in slow motion like so many cases pending and all those things. It cannot happen like that, right? Now right, we are seeing a tussle between judiciary and executive, and they are not appointing judges. And right now there was a very good thing which happened. Chief Justice was saying that we can work on Saturdays, so that is the way to go, and hope this thing prevails, right? And they start doing, means they start working more, judiciary start working more, and executives start appointing more. So that is the whole thing, right? Okay, but the thing is, yeah, this under trial thing, this is not at all good, and this is a black spot on our Indian justice system. And two-third means 67% of the prisoners are under trials. So that is a very, very big number. Okay, now let's talk about insolvency and bankruptcy code. So here we will not talk about all the intricacies of insolvency and bankruptcy code. What we'll do, we'll try to see what are the limitations and what are the issues regarding insolvency and bankruptcy code. And it still needs judiciary. Hand holding of judiciary is still required in insolvency and bankruptcy code because of its technicalities. So let's see. So the thing is, insolvency and bankruptcy code has loopholes, and it is more preferring, or it is more helping to close down business instead of assisting entrepreneurs. It is not assisting entrepreneurs in right now. The format of insolvency and bankruptcy code is in such a way that it is assisting to close down business. It is helping in closing down business, but it is not helping in assisting entrepreneurs. So first of all, what were the aims of insolvency and bankruptcy code? There were three primary aims of insolvency and bankruptcy code. First aim was to overhaul laws related to reorganization and insolvency resolution. Whatever laws we earlier have, so they were overhauling all those laws, and they were making a single law which could deal with all those cases, right? So the first aim was to overhaul laws related to reorganization and insolvency resolution. Second aim was to ease the process of recovery of money by operational and financial creditors in a timely manner. Suppose take an example of Sahara. Sahara is a bad example, but even then, let's assume that they go bankrupt. But in that scenario also, if they go through this particular law, they should get something out of it, right? They should get something. So to speed up that particular process, insolvency and bankruptcy code was designed, right? Okay, and the third aim was, it places the onus on professionals to put forth resolution plans within 180 days. So it places the onus on professionals only, the business professional only. They will put forward a resolution plan within 180 days, approximately 6 months, right? So how they will go about this whole insolvency thing, right? Okay, so these were the three aims. Now what are the issues related to insolvency and bankruptcy code? There are two main issues. First thing is, and it is a very serious issue when you will read about it. So the first issue is, it allows for any person to access information memorandum put together by insolvency professional without restricting competitors or imposing any confidentiality obligations. So if Sahara is putting certain informations, so all these informations are open, are there on the open platform. So it can help their competitors. So that is not good, right? So that is the first issue. The second issue is, It prohibits withdrawal of application once the same has been admitted. So suppose Satyam, or suppose take any company. So they have given their application that they want. They are going insolvent and they want this thing to be done quickly. But after a certain point of time, they feel that no, they can get rid of it. They can, what do you say, come out of it. So that thing is not available right now. So if you have given your application, you cannot withdraw it. So that is the main thing. So these are the two issues. The first thing is information is open, and second thing is you cannot withdraw your application. Now the thing is, now let's talk about what we can do and what is happening because of these things. So unrestricted access of any person, unrestricted action of any person without mandatory contractual obligations in relation to confidentiality vitiates the fundamental right to business under Article 19(1)(g). Right? So Article 19(1)(g) is related to fundamental right to business. So they are saying that if any person can access all these contractual obligations, so it is violating this fundamental right to business under Article 19(1)(g). So if any question on insolvency and bankruptcy code come, na, you can talk about it. That information memorandum is open, right? So anybody can access it, and it is violating right to fundamental right to business under Article 19(1)(g). Okay. The thing is, again, the code, this insolvency and bankruptcy code, it still requires a lot of hand-holding by judiciary to put in place adequate safeguards. So that is the whole thing, right? All these national company law tribunal and all those things, fine. But the thing is, still insolvency and bankruptcy code is suffering from lots and lots of issues, and this openness has to go. And the second thing is withdrawal of application has to be allowed, right? So all these things are there, right? Okay, so let's move on to the next topic. So the next topic is Indian economy since LPG. What is LPG? That is liberalization, privatization and globalization. It is not liquefied petroleum gas. So the thing is, 1991 LPG reforms freed the economy, but the next big set of reforms yet to take off. After that, there is no big reform which has taken place. You can argue about GST, but let's see what happens. Even in GST, we don't have a single tax. We have multiple taxes, and even petroleum and all those products are outside of the purview of it, right? So let's see how it goes. So the thing is, after 1991 LPG reforms, we don't have any big set of reforms yet. The thing is, labor, agriculture reforms may be painful but necessary to change lives, mostly untouched by 1991. After 1991, whatever reforms have happened and people who were affected by it, they are not people involved in labor or agriculture market, right? Those domains are still unaffected by 1991 reforms. And if we want them to, what do you say, reap the benefits of 1991 reforms, we have to bring some structural reforms in labor and agriculture sector. That is the need of the hour. Similarly, the thing is, not all change of last 25 years are good. Air and water are getting dirtier, and forest cover is reducing or retreating. So all these things are there. Even in defense, what is happening? Even in defense, we are getting equipments, but we are not getting technology. So, but now we are, improving FDI in defense. But the thing is, there's also a case whether in organizing appropriate weapon supply or developing our internal infrastructure, our defense situation suffers from amateuriness and neglect. So even in defense structure, in defense, equipment purchase and all those things, we're still lagging behind. So we ask from other countries that give us the technology and give us the equipments. They are like, no, we'll give you only the equipments, we won't give you the technology, right? So that is the thing. Technology transfer is very, very critical in defense, right? So that has also not taken place. But the thing is, slowly, it is happening. Israel is helping us and America is not, but it will happen. It will happen surely. And yeah, let's see how it goes. Now let's talk about economic survey. So the second volume has come in August, that period of time, right? In that period it has come, right? The thing is, let's analyze, because different articles were written on economic survey, so we will summarize all those articles. So the thing is, what is economic survey saying? Economic survey is saying that there's weakness in industrial growth. We all know it, right? But the other point which they are saying is, very few people know it. They are saying that investment to GDP ratio is steadily falling for 5 years in a row. Investment to investment divided by GDP ratio is steadily falling for 5 years in a row. Okay, so that is the thing. So that means we know it why it is falling, right? Because private investment it is facing a drought like situation. From the last 10-15 years, private investment is dull, very dull. So investment to GDP ratio will obviously go down, right? Now, but there are certain silver lining also, according to economic survey. So they are saying that there are four major reforms which are silver lining, right? So what are those four major reforms? First is GST. Second is new insolvency and bankruptcy code, which we have talked about. Third is new monetary policy framework, which is targeting inflation. And fourth is Aadhaar linkage to government services, which will plug out the loopholes, which will plug out the leakages, which will remove the most beneficiaries, right? So these are the four silver linings according to Economic Survey. Now there were other articles written on Economic Survey also, so let's talk about them as well. Now, before talking about those things, they have talked about something called real effective exchange rate, that is REEL. So you have to understand what is real effective exchange rate and what is nominal effective exchange rate. I will tell you simple, in simple words, right? Because wherever I have studied, they have made it very complex. So I will just tell you in simple words. See, if it is written that $1 equals to rupees 60, so that thing which you see, na, that is nominal exchange rate. Now let's talk about real exchange rate. Now that thing is nominal exchange rate plus if you take into consideration what is the price of a commodity in India as compared to the price in US. So that means if you club together nominal exchange rate with purchasing power parity, you get something which is called real exchange rate. So that is real effective exchange rate. Now let's talk about Economic Survey, what they are saying about real effective exchange rate. So they are saying that India's real effective exchange rate has appreciated significantly, right? So what will that mean? That means our export will become our export will go down and our import will become cheaper, right? Okay, so RBI has unviable challenge of managing significant inward capital flows with exchange rates which do not penalize domestic industry through a premium on cheaper imports. Now this is a very technical line, so I will solve it for you, or I will make it easier for you. See, the thing is, they are saying since our rupee has become more attractive now, so what will happen? Capital flow will come from other countries, right? So in that scenario, what will happen? Our import will become cheaper. So if import is becoming cheaper, nobody will buy goods from our domestic industry, right? So that will hamper our domestic industry. So that's why they are saying, I will again reiterate that line because it is a very important line, you can note it down in your copy. So they are saying, Economic Survey is saying that RBI has unenviable challenge of managing significant inward capital flows with exchange rates which do not penalize domestic industry through a premium on cheaper imports. I hope you understand the whole line because this is important. Another thing is what is happening with states. So the thing is, there is a case of fiscal tightening by states due to UDAY, that is Ujjwal Discom Assurance Yojana. Farm loan waivers, a new trend which is going on. Remember, farm loan waivers started in 1990. Okay, and declining profitability of some key sectors like power and telecom. Twin balance sheet problem. Now, twin balance sheet problem means over leveraged companies and bad loan encumbered banks. So you can write it in 2 points, that first is over leveraged company and second is bad loan encumbered banks. And transitional issue of GST are contributory to deflationary pressure. So they are saying, Economic Survey is time and again saying that there is a very high chance of India going through a deflationary scenario, right? So if deflation happens, employment will reduce, and if employment reduce, it will affect anybody and everybody, right? So they are cautioning policymakers of a possible deflationary cycle because of all these things which is happening, because states are facing fiscal tightening because of UDAY, loan waivers, declining profitability, twin balance sheet problem, GST transitional issues. Okay, we'll talk about GST. In GST also, you will see now they have again changed the rate and everything, but that is for another time. The thing is, what is the way forward? So way forward, what Economic Survey is saying is there should be a faster resolution to twin balance sheet, which is critical to rekindling private investment. Second thing which they are saying is government should accelerate pace of agricultural reforms, targeted capital expenditure, improving ease of doing business, and multiple infrastructure initiatives. So they should improve ease of doing business. Okay, we are improving 131 to 130, but we have to improve further, right? Similarly, we have to take infrastructure initiative. See, infrastructure initiative, you can write anywhere and everywhere because that is needed, right? Okay, and again, so first thing was, what was Economic Survey saying for the way forward? First thing is the resolution of twin balancing. Second thing is all these things, structural reforms. Third thing is stressed sectors like telecom and power need special, speedier resolution. So you have to take special care of telecom and power sector. Okay, and they need speedier resolution. They are having too much leverage, right? So they need speedier resolution. And there's a famous quotation which says that the basic prescription of preventing deflation is not to get into it in the first place, right? So the basic prescription of preventing deflation is not to get into it in the first place. Okay, so this was about Economic Survey. So let's talk about National Electric Mobility Mission Plan. So the thing is, this is about electric vehicles. So the thing is, and our recent power minister has said that from 2013, only electric vehicles will be sold in India. So let's talk about this article. So they are saying that research and smart trade agreements needed to realize India's ambitious electric vehicles target. Power Ministry announcement that only electric vehicles will be sold in India from 2030. The National Electric Mobility Mission Plan, that is NEMMP, has a sales target of only 5 to 7 million EVs, that is electric vehicles and hybrid electric vehicles, annually by 2020. Even Shah Rukh Khan has, I think, bought an electric vehicle. So right now, I think we will also buy it sooner or later. I like cycle, but again, the thing is we have to buy it, right? So the thing is, what are the issues? The thing is, what are the issues regarding this electric vehicle industry and this whole thing, right? So there are two major issues which is hampering NEMMP, right? So the first issue is India's limited hold on critical lithium reserve, which is needed for electric vehicles. And the second is concentration of production in hands of a few. Only few companies are making electric vehicles. So it has to go to more hands, right? More companies should come forward. Now, what is the way forward? What is the way forward to implement NEMMP successfully and to improve or to increase the number of electric vehicles in India? So the way forward is policies that incentivize domestic manufacturing, address the need for virgin resources, that is less resources, and recycling of used batteries, while constantly pushing R&D for substitutes and alternatives, are vital to secure electric mobility. So all these things are needed. We need more resources because we have less resources regarding electric vehicles. Similarly, we need R&D. R&D we need in everything. We are very poor in R&D in most of the sectors, right? And we need different alternatives, right? Similarly, we need critical lithium reserves also because we don't have that. So these are all the things which we need to secure electric mobility. Okay, so I will keep until here only. Thank you.